Welcome to our presentation. My name is Natalie Rudolph and I'm the Business Field Manager Polymer at NETZSCH Analyzing and Testing.
And my name is Catherine Kelly and I'm a postdoc researcher at the University of Birmingham. So today we're going to talk to you about the blending and degradation analysis of the heat sensitive biodegradable polymer, polyhydroxybutyrate-co-hydroxyvalerate.
The research was performed by a couple of people and not all of them can be here today, but we want to mention our colleagues, Dr. Shauna Marsh and Dr. Mike Jenkins. Now, Dr. Kelly is going to introduce the topic and the motivation of the whole research project.
Plastic packaging and its end of life disposal is becoming a worldwide concern for many reasons. It uses up valuable resources of oil during the polymer synthesis and also processing. Recycling levels are low, with many items such as films and laminates not collected at the curbside. And this is mainly as the recycling streams cannot deal with thin films or with multiple materials. A significant amount have also been found to enter rivers, seas and soils, where they've been found to disintegrate into microparticles. And these can harm marine life and also enter the food chain. A new EU directive has been developed on the reduction and even elimination of single-use products. There are some current solutions out there, but they aren't ideal, such as paper, which results in large-scale deforestation, glass, which is much heavier than polymers, so therefore higher fuel costs and therefore a higher carbon footprint, and also compostable materials. These often have high glass transition temperatures and require industrial composting and will not compost at home. One possible solution is polyhydroxybutyrate-co-hydroxyvalerate. It is synthesized by bacteria as a means of energy storage during nutrient limitation. The bacteria is fed on sugar sources and then it stores the polymer as up to 90% of its cell weight. And this can be seen in the picture at the top right-hand corner. It can also be shown that it can be fed on waste sources as well. It is biodegradable at room temperature and has been shown to degrade in the soil into water and carbon dioxide with a 70% weight loss in under 4 months. In addition, it's extracted from the bacteria and processed and gives initial properties similar to other packaging materials like PET and polypropylene. However, there are some problems currently with this polymer. It's thermally unstable close to the melting point, which means that careful consideration must be taken when processing. It also undergoes secondary crystallization over time. This is when a polymer's glass transition temperature is below room temperature and therefore the polymer chains have a degree of mobility. This enables them to rearrange and we get thickening of the lamella and excess crystallinity. This causes progressive embrittlement of the polymer in the time frame of just weeks and months and can be extremely harmful if packaging heavy materials such as meat products, as these can just break apart. One solution that I've previously investigated is to blend this material with polyethylene glycol. The hydroxyl groups in polyethylene glycol are able to interact with the carbonyl of PHBV, and this forms physical crosslinks, which then hinders the rearrangements needed for the secondary crystallization. If we look at the plot on the left, we can see the stress strain curve of the pure polymer, and you can see in just 24 hours, the elongation is reduced from 20% down to 14%. And even further with greater time. If we look at the plot on the right, it shows the change in elongation with time. As you can see with the PHBV, there's a great change of 12% elongation in about 80 days. But when the addition of PEG is there, this rate is much slower.
So now that we're talking about blending, we want to understand if the product that we're creating out of the PHBV and the PEG actually is miscible. And because the crystallinity of the PHBV is very high, no TG is observable in a DSC measurement. So we use rheology to assess the miscibility, and the typical way to do that is an Hahn plot, where you perform frequency sweeps in the linear viscoelastic region against the loss modulus, as is shown in the graph below. And then Hahn stated that a deviation from the linear relationship indicates immiscibility. So as you see in that green curve, linear relationship confirms miscibility. So measurements were performed to blend that material in a two-roll mill. That was done at 165 degrees C for 5 minutes. And then this mixture was analyzed in a NETZSCH Kinexus rheometer using parallel plate geometry, 20 millimeters. And to understand the viscoelastic behavior, we measured in oscillation and at the typical temperature of 185 degrees C. Below you see a couple of the other measurement conditions. Important is that we use the low strain rate of 0.5%. And then on the right, you see the resulting graph and you see how the storage and loss modulus as well as the complex viscosity decrease over the measurement time, which indicates unfortunately degradation and not the end of the linear viscoelastic region. And this degradation is really causing us problems. This alternative method for thermally labeled materials was proposed by Yamaguchi and Arakawa, who performed time studies at a range of frequencies and then looked at the change over time. We performed the time studies at a strain of 0.5%. And then at the bottom, you can see as one example, the storage modulus plotted as a function of time for the different frequencies under investigation. Then this data was transversed to actually plot the storage modulus against frequency at every 60-second interval. And you already see something that looks very close to a master curve. And then a horizontal shift was performed to actually superimpose the data and generate that master curve. Then Dr. Kelly had the idea to look at the shift immediately and was able to see that the plotting the logarithmic shift factor against time generated a completely straight line. And that's real measurement. So the error was close to zero, if not zero. And you can see that the straight line deviates a little bit from the point zero. So she used the plot to calculate the shift factor required for time zero by doing another horizontal shift. And now using all these shift factors to produce the master curve at time zero for the storage and modulus of each sample. On this graph here, you first see the storage and modulus of the pure PHBV. And you see that the loss modulus is higher than the storage modulus. And now as we look at all the samples, you have the pure PHBV again as blue, and then different concentrations of PEG from low, medium to high. And you see with the increase of the concentration, both the storage and loss modulus decrease because the intermolecular hydrogen bonds in the PHBV chains are disrupted by the PEG. Now, if you add even higher amounts of PEG, so that means, for example, increase the molecular weight, you can see that as that effect of disruption is even stronger. You see the same effect that with increasing molecular weight, which is here denoted by the increase of the number 200, 400 to 600 that the storage and loss modulus are again affected by molecular weight and decrease with increasing molecular weight. Now this data was used to generate the Hahn plot. So plot the storage modulus against the loss modulus and you can see a straight line. It's further indicated or added the pure PHBV. That obviously isn't the blend, and you can see that it follows the same linear relationship that indicates that the material is miscible in any blend concentration and molecular weight of the PEG. Now, understanding the miscibility, the next very important part for understanding and using that material was study the degradation behavior.
So as Natalie mentioned, the reduction in the storage modulus, loss modulus, and complex viscosity is found with time due to degradation of the polymer. And the rates of this degradation can be used to look at the effect of molecular weight and concentration of PEG on the PHBV degradation. So PHBV displays first order kinetics as only chain cleavage occurs. If you look at the mechanism below, you can see that an intermediate ring structure is formed, which then allows the degradation to occur through breakage of the ester linkage. So as PHBV undergoes first order kinetics, we can use this equation to determine the rate parameters, where MO is the monomer weight and MW the molecular weight at time zero and time t. As we know, the viscosity can be related to the molecular weight using this equation. This usually occurs in the zero shear region. However, due to the degradation of this polymer, we are unable to see this. We therefore use this equation as a guide to determine the effects of the PEG molecular weight and concentration. If we combine these two equations together, we can reach the following expression, which can then be used to determine the degradation rate. Plotting 1 over the viscosity to the power of 1 over 3.4 versus time, we generated a straight line equation for each of the blends with R squared values greater than 0.99. So this confirms the degradation process does follow first order kinetics. We can then use the gradient to determine the rate of degradation. So we looked at the rate of degradation for PHBV and found that it was 6.48 times 10 to the minus 5 seconds to the minus 1. On the addition of PEG, this then increased to 7.91 times 10 to the minus 5. And as we increase the PEG concentration further, this degradation rate increased even more. The same was also found with the molecular weight. As the molecular weight of the polymer increased, the degradation rate also increased. So this shows that the addition of PEG increased the degradation rate. And the main reason for this is PEG also lowers the viscosity of the material. And this facilitates the rearrangement into the intermediate cyclic ring structure and therefore encourages transition to occur more readily. Increases in the PEG concentration and molecular weight were both found to accelerate this effect. However, the addition of PEG also allows PHBV to be processed at a much lower temperature. So we did some tests with this with PEG 400 at the medium content and found that we could actually analyse the viscosity at temperatures as low as 178 degrees C, whereas previously with PHBV, we could only analyse it at 185 degrees C. So we then compared the degradation rates at these two temperatures for these two materials. We found that PEG 400, the degradation at 178 degrees C, the degradation was reduced to 3.6 times 10 to the minus 5. And this was nearly half of the degradation of rate of PHBV at 185 degrees C.
So let me briefly summarize the findings of this study. The PHBV thermally degrades during the rheology analysis to study miscibility. So therefore, a modified method allows the Hahn-Plot to be applied to thermally label materials. PHBV and PEG are miscible in the melt at each concentration and molecular weight analyzed. So that was a very important finding. The rheology can be used to further probe the degradation of PHBV in the presence of PEG. And PEG increases the rate of degradation. However, as the material can be processed at a lower temperature, the overall extent of degradation is reduced. And this is one of the key findings of the study as it relates to the application of the material. Even so, it looks as the degradation rate increases, and that's a bad thing. The very important finding is that the lower temperature that we can use for processing and therefore lower degree of degradation really takes us a big step towards using that material as a packaging material in the future, adding material to the portfolio of materials we can use in plastic packaging and solve some of the big issues of our time. With that, we'd like to thank you for your attention. And we have our contact information below if you're interested in learning more about this particular research or other things we're doing and you want to get in touch if you have further questions.